Hello everyone, welcome once again to another segment of the revision series. So May month was very important from national news and international news, all right? So we'll be doing this in two parts because if you know, on 2nd of May, we had the results of the assembly election. Now from election perspective, we have very limited questions, all right? But there is always a chance of them coming up nevertheless, right? So moving on first with the national news. The first news that we are going to talk about is DD International. During the month of March and April, Indian government faced heavy criticism at international forums. International reporters flocked to India to report our mismanagement of the COVID second wave. They reported about oxygen shortage, they reported about lack of medical facilities in India. So the Indian government, under its public broadcaster, has now decided to come up with an international channel to talk about India's point of view to the world population. All right, so the channel name will be DD International, Doordarshan International. Okay, it will be a government owned channel. So basically it is going to be a government. There is a difference between how channels in India work and how the BBC work. DD was identified on the idea of British Broadcasting Company. However, India's channels less or rarely cover any story that is a criticism of any of the state bodies, all right? So this is the distinction. However, the name of the channel becomes important. Then in the month of May, Indian government gave nod for the trials of the fifth generation of telecommunication technology, 5G as we know it. The difference between 4G and 5G is not just that 5G is faster, all right, but there is a difference on the level of latency. For example, whenever I am speaking and then taking breaks, catching my breath, then speaking again, right? In connection terms, that is known as latency. All right. Every time we speak or every time we have a 4G connection, there is a latency. All right. So you do see a drop in connection at different point of time. All right. However, 5G is considered a network connection that has zero latency, continuous connection at all wavelengths. All right. So 5G is seen important for driverless cars, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, that is completely interconnected households, appliances, everything connected to one hub, right? So therefore 5G requires continuous connectivity. Through 5G, it is possible to conduct surgeries via robots. That's all the idea, right? But right now 5G is still in a very beginner stage, all right? It's in very nascent stage, and thus the Indian government finally gave nod. So telecommunication companies of India, that is Jio, Airtel and Vodafone Idea, they are the three companies that exist in India. They will be conducting trials of 5G along with the brands for 5G such as Ericsson, Nokia, Samsung and C-Dot. Chinese companies have been left out of it, all right, such as ZTE or Huawei. All right, why have they been left out? Because of the security risk. When you are on a 5G network, all right, a lot of security data will also be held in such a network. If you own the network, you own the data. And if any of your enemy owns the data, right, such as a Chinese company, then there is no real security of your data. And therefore, a lot of countries across the world have been blocking out Chinese companies from their 5G market, all right. So this was confirmed in India's trials also, all right. BSNL, which is the state corporation, was not given 4G wavelength and now has also been left out of the 5G trials, all right. Then this was also the month when we had a new chief of the CBI. The position of CBI director had been empty since the month of January, all right. So Subodh Kumar Jaiswal is the new CBI director. The panel for CBI director is the Prime Minister as its chairman, the Chief Justice of India and the Leader of Opposition in Lok Sabha, all right. His tenure will be of 2 years or less, all right. This is a change in the policy that was earlier in the Supreme Court judgments. In 1997, Supreme Court had called that the minimum tenure of a CBI director should at least be 2 years. years, all right? But when the notification for the appointment of the new CBI director came out, it had a provision that his tenure could even be curtailed, all right? The previous CBI director had been marred in a turf war with his own junior, where his junior had found out corruption cases against him. So both of them were removed at an earlier point of time, all right? However, to avoid such a fiasco in future, the government has probably done this. So this is a fact that it was worth pointing out, that the tenure of the CBI director can now be less than 2 years also, all right? Then moving on now to the assembly elections. So the month of March and April were when the elections had taken place. Only West Bengal had such a long election until eight phases. Every other state had maximum four phases. So one of the only union territory to go to polls along with the assembly elections was of Puducherry. All right. So Puducherry comprises of four districts: Puducherry, Karaikal, Mahe and Yanam. There are a total of 30 seats. Three seats are nominated by the central government. The Alliance of All India NR Rangaswamy Congress won, all right, along with the BJP. They secured 16 votes in the House, right? So the chief minister will be N. Rangaswamy. He'll be the ninth chief minister of the state. The current governor, lieutenant governor of Puducherry, because it's a union territory, so the position is of a lieutenant governor. It is Tamilisai Sundarajan, all right? She is the additional in charge of Pondicherry or Puducherry. She is the governor of Tamil Nadu, all right? Then the Tamil Nadu Assembly election saw the coming back of Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam, or the DMK, defeating the All India DMK, right? This was the reason this election stand out was for the first time the election was held without the two stalwarts from each party, all right? Since 1960s, Tamil Nadu has been either rotating between DMK or AIDMK. The last Congress chief minister was Bey back in the first decade of India's independence. Since then, no national party has gained political power in Tamil Nadu, all right? So in this election also, this was the first one to be held without Karunanidhi and J. Jayalalitha, the former CM, the two former CMs. The alliance of DMK and Congress secured 159 seats out of 234, all right? The governor is Tamilisai Sundarajan. The chief minister is Muthuvel Karunanidhi Stalin, or MK Stalin, as he is known by his followers. Then the West Bengal Assembly election, you all know, the most high-pitched one across the country was the West Bengal. Here, Mamata Banerjee secured victory for the third time. Since 2011, she has been the chief minister. All right. West Bengal is also a unicameral legislature. However, the government has now approved to create a second house in the state. All right. The Legislative Council. All right. The governor is Jagjeep Dhankar. The current chief minister is Mamata Banerjee. Now, Mamata Banerjee may not remain chief minister. Why? Because she lost her election at Nandigram. This election is also in news because yesterday only, all right, on the day of me recording this, a day before this, Supreme Court has admitted petition, the Calcutta High Court has admitted petition wherein the challenge to the election in Nandigram has been accepted, in the sense, when the election results were declared by election commissioner, then first it was declared that Mamata Banerjee had won. Half an hour later, it was confirmed his opponent Suvendu Adhikari won the election. So in that, Mamata Banerjee challenged the election. The Calcutta High Court will now be seeing the proceedings, all right? So therefore, this is the state as of now. Then the Kerala Assembly election, for the first time since 1980s, there was no rotation between government and opposition, all right? The LDF, the Left Democratic Front, retained power under Pinayari Vijayan, all right? The Communist Party of India, Marxist CPIM, all right? And the governor there is Arif Mohammed Khan. Then Assam Assembly election. So Assam Assembly election was also important from one perspective of constitutional voting mechanism, right? So here there were two main alliances, one led by the Bharatiya Janata Party and one by the Indian National Congress, all right? So the BJP alliance secured majority in the state, getting some 70-odd seats in the state. And the chief minister now is Hemant Biswa Sarma. He was the home minister in the previous government, all right? The then chief minister has now been promoted to a cabinet minister. That is Sarbananda Sonowal, okay? The governor there is Jagdish Mukhi. Now, why do we need to talk about the Assam election? Is for one reason. In India, we have a voting system that is known as the first-past-the-post system, all right? The total votes received by both these alliances, all right, come across approximately to 44.38 versus the other party's 43.80, all right? A difference less than 1%, all right? However, the difference between the total seats won by each of the party is more than 20, all right? So, this highlights the positioning of first-past-the-post system. That irrespective of how much or how close your vote share is, you may end up to very less seats. The national elections had also pointed this out, wherein, for example, the Congress party right now received 20% of the vote share in the national election, but got seats less than 10%, all right? So, this is the two mechanisms of voting. Why will we need to talk about the other mechanism, which is proportionate representation, all right? In the month of June, elections to Israel took place once again, all right? There will be a government change in Israel, and in April, May, the tussle for government is going on. There, the system is of proportional representation, that you get seats based on the proportion of total votes that you get, all right? For example, if the Congress alliance here got 43.8 and the Bharatiya Janata Party alliance got 44.38. Both the parties would have actually failed to get a majority. However, here this political party, this alliance got almost 69% of the seats in the assembly, all right? So therefore, it's 59 actually, okay? So this is why I spoke about it. Because elections are there, if there is a question from general knowledge, it could be part of your constitution perspective also. And therefore, in India, for all general elections, all right, except for the election of the president, Rajya Sabha members and the vice president, we follow the system of first past the post system, all right? Then moving on, in the month of May was also the 43rd GST Council meet, all right? The 43rd GST Council met, which was the first meeting of them for the financial year 2021. Now, the GST Council is a constitutional body under Article 279A. It was brought in through the GST Amendment Act. All right, GST is a new law that was passed in 2016. Under this, there is the central government, and all the chief ministers and their finance ministers are also part of the GST Council. All right, what does the council do? It decides on the tax rate in the country on each commodity. The GST Council was asked to remove the GST that is there on different COVID relief equipment such as oxygen concentrators, all right, COVID-19 vaccines, their general ingredients, but the council decided not to do it. Now, the constitutional nature of the GST Council is equally important to be discussed. It can be part of the legal GK that you may get in the examination, all right? And you also keep on hearing in news that about the GST dues pertaining to each state, all right? So first, what is the GST Council? It's a constitutional body chaired by the Union Finance Minister right now is Nirmala Sitharaman, all right? And members, other members are Union State Ministers of Revenue or Finance, okay? It's a federal body where both center and state get representation. Now, what are the GST dues, all right, or the compensation cess? This was a cess that was levied on GST. Prior to GST, states used to decide on their own taxation, all right. But because they gave up that power, there was a lapse on GST revenue that they had. For example, Maharashtra, which economy is higher, used to tax less than, for example, Rajasthan or Madhya Pradesh, landlocked states that used to tax more because their business model was based on the economy within the country itself. All right. So there were lapse in revenue after GST. Now, who will compensate for it? Because we are giving up power for it. It was decided that the central government, whatever GST it will get, it will compensate the states for that. This was this compensation cess on GST, all right, to compensate the states for the loss of revenue arising out of implementation of GST. Earlier, it was decided for 5 years. It can be extended also, all right. Then moving on, the cabinet cleared the proposal to privatize IDBI Bank. All right, so IDBI Bank is been the first one to be the one that will be privatized. In the month of January, we discussed the intention of the government to privatize commercial banks. The first one will be IDBI Bank, earlier established in 1964 as a development financial institution, all right, DFI, which are this year's union budget is recreating, all right. So the DFI, it was originally established as DFI, converted into a commercial bank in 2004 after it had run into huge losses. But right now the bank has been suffering. Its business is low, there is high NPA, so the government has decided it is going to divest its funding from the IDBI Bank. It is a subsidiary or it is owned by the LIC, all right, and this will be the first bank to be privatized. Then in national news is about certain important Supreme Court judgments that came out. The first one was a petition filed by the Election Commission wherein the Madras High Court had actually criticized the organization of assembly elections. Post the assembly elections, there was a huge spike in cases. West Bengal, which had the longest elections, still is reporting the highest number of cases and is in lockdown. All right. All the states that actually had elections had a huge spike in COVID cases. All right. So the Madras High Court had criticized the Election Commission and even called for charges of manslaughter or murder to be charged on Election Commission officials for the way they organized and failed to implement COVID protocols during election. So the Election Commission went to Supreme Court and stated that you should stop the media from reporting this because Election Commission is a constitutional body and people's confidence in the constitutional body should not be lowered at any point of time. So the Supreme Court, refusing the petition of Election Commission, held that under Article 19, the information or the reports of this court proceedings are part of your constitutional fundamental right to receive information. Under Article 19, we have right to freedom of information, also right to free speech, and within that we have the right to receive information. The right to receive information was earlier confirmed in Anuradha Bhasin versus Union of India. And in this judgment, it was confirmed that court proceedings are also part of public knowledge and media cannot be stopped from reporting them. All right. It also cited the example of Gujarat High Court's live streaming of all proceedings. Gujarat High Court proceedings can be seen live by anyone in the country. All proceedings are open to the public. All right. So this is an example of right to receive information under Article 19. All right. Then was another judgment related to resolution of debt. In India, corporate debt has been a huge problem. Businesses taking money and then never paying it back. All right. So the court, the Supreme Court in the this case confirmed that if each loan has a personal guarantor, if the corporate fails to pay back its loans, the personal guarantor will be liable to pay them back. All right. So what will happen? For example, there is a corporation ABC that took loan. All right. And X had guaranteed the loan. The loan, let's say, was 100 crore. All right. ABC declared itself bankrupt. So ABC's assets were liquidated under IBC. We have talked about IBC multiple times, but they were only able to recover 50 crore. So the remaining 50 crore will be paid by Mr. X, all right, who is a personal guarantor, all right. So this will now be permissible. The personal guarantors had stated that, see, why should we be made accountable to pay back? We only became guarantors because it was our friend or someone else, or because it's a responsibility. But that does not mean we actually spent the 100 crore, because we had no control on how the company was spending 100 crore and they ran that into the ground or in losses. Why should we pay it back? The court stated this is no excuse. This is something part of your due diligence that you should have carried out when you became a guarantor of a loan. All right. So this is going to be a huge relief to public sector banks who are trying to recoup the loans they have been giving out to corporations. All right. But remember, their liability will only arise after the company's assets have been liquidated. All right. So if the asset value was 10 rupees or 10 crore, then 90 crore will be the liability. Whatever assets ke baad jitna liability hoga, that will be paid by the personal guarantor. All right. Then another judgment by the Supreme Court was about the Maratha reservation. All right. In 2018, the state of Maharashtra declared that the Maratha community is also backward and granted them reservation in tune of 12% and 13% for education and jobs. All right. Back then, states used to determine on whatever the criteria for whether a community is backward or not. All right. However, the Supreme Court declared this reservation as unconstitutional. All right. On three grounds. The first one was because in India right now we have an upper limit of 50% for reservation. All right. 50% reservation limit, upper limit, in the sense that under this, 27 is for other backward caste, which was introduced by the Mandal Commission. There is 8% for scheduled tribes, and then there is 16% for scheduled caste. So if someone was declared backward, if a community was declared backward, they would have got reservation within this 27%. However, in the Maratha reservation, except beyond this 27%, 12% reservation was given to the Maratha community. So the Supreme Court held that this is a violation of the fundamental right. How can you claim that this community is more backward than the other backward communities that already have reservation? How can you differentiate between one backward community to all the others? That this is a blatant violation of right to equality, where the law is treating one community backward on a different pedestal than other communities on a backward or different pedestal. This, the court also held, would lead to a caste ruled state in India, where whichever caste comes to power will actually declare reservation for themselves and disenfranchise all the other castes that actually have reservation. All right. Then the court also claimed this was a violation of Article 21, that is due process of law, that the process of law wherein you have to determine how a community is backward, have quantifiable data to declare them backward, was also not present. All right. Then the court stated the second standard on why it was declared unconstitutional is because of the case of Indira Sahani. A 9-judge bench in 1992 had declared that 50% shall be the rule, and only in extreme, exceptional and extraordinary situation can this rule be relaxed. All right. If we have to go reservation beyond 50%, exceptional circumstances have to be proven, and that the state of Maharashtra failed to prove these exceptional circumstances. Along with this, the Maratha judgment also held the 102nd Amendment Act as constitutional. All right. And it stated that states have no power to actually determine whether a community is backward or not. All right. In 2018, the central government brought in an amendment and created a body. What is this body? National Commission for Backward Classes. All right. This was created under Article 338B to create a constitutional body, which stated and gave this commission and solely this commission the power to prepare a report as to whether a community should be declared backward or not. All right. When this commission existed, the Maharashtra government had no power to actually declare the Maratha community or any community. Let's say tomorrow also, the Rajasthan government wants to declare ABC community with reservation. They also cannot do. Now, the system is all the states can give recommendation to the NCBC and to tell them that, see, this is a community, this is the data why they are backward, and we believe they should be included. All right. So the NCBC will create the report. All right. And then under Article 342A, only the president via law can declare those communities as backward. All right. So this is the standard that was now then the constitution. So therefore, the Maratha reservation was declared unconstitutional, because if this is the constitutional mechanism, a state law cannot overpower the constitution. So you can get multiple questions from this area. First, what is the standard or why the Maratha reservation was declared unconstitutional? First, on right to equality. Then, violation of due process of law. Third, it violated Indira Sahni judgment. And lastly, it was in contrast to the National Commission for Backward Classes and the constitutional provisions within it. All right. Okay. So, 102nd Amendment created this constitutional body. What is this constitutional body? It is the sole body that can now determine whether a community is backward or not. Parliament will pass a law to state or include a body, and then the president will declare it as a law. All right. So, this is now the new rule in India. All right. Then moving on was the two cyclonic storms that we had in India. All right. Yas was the second one. The first was Tauktae. Yas was more severe. It was a very severe cyclonic storm, made landfall in Balasore in Odisha. All right. Cyclones, their categorization is severe, very severe, extremely severe, or super cyclonic storms. All right. The tropical cyclones are intense circular storms that originate over warm tropical oceans. As climate change happens and earth becomes hotter, surface of sea becomes hotter, therefore we will witness more and more cyclonic storms with higher severity than previously known. All right. Cyclonic storms rotate counterclockwise in northern hemisphere and in clockwise mechanism in the southern hemisphere. All right. The name of Yas was given by Oman. All right. Then the first cyclonic storm that came was Tauktae or Tauktae. All right. It is given by Myanmar. The name was given by Myanmar. All right. The cyclonic storm went from Kerala and then made landfall in Gujarat. All right. It was named, it means gecko or a highly vocal lizard in Burmese language. The criteria, it was a very severe cyclonic storm and had started out as an extremely severe cyclonic storm. Who declares names to these organizations? World Meteorological Department, with each region having its own body. India's is included in the 13-member region, all right, which is Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Myanmar, Oman, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Yemen. All right. The two all the countries surrounding Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal. All right. So they are the one who are part of the World Meteorological Group to name the cyclonic storms in this particular region. All right. So then we will move on now to the international news segment, which we will cover in the second part.